So welcome everyone, and this is a new format that I want to try out, where I recap some of my previous videos and share some information or feedback of things that I found out in the meantime. But also I want to share my thoughts about new products that popped up in the market. And you please let me know if you like this type of video, and if you do, I will do more often going forward. One of the first things that I want to talk about is my previous video of the Fiotech G5 GoPro gimbal. Maybe I came across a little salty, but this wasn't really my intention. If you're into action sports and you take your GoPro to places where you'll likely be getting wet, I think it's a great piece of equipment. However, if you're a person like me who uses it for every day and you also want to use the onboard audio of your GoPro, really it's not the money well spent. Simply because the audio noise or the motor noise that the GoPro picks up is so loud that the only thing that you end up doing is get rid of the onboard audio altogether and just put some music under your footage, and that's pretty much it. And I think, again, you know, for some of you that might be the right piece of equipment. For me, definitely it wasn't. Also, that the gimbal touches or hits the GoPro in that, I mean, it just doesn't make sense. The next thing that I want to talk about is my Panasonic LX10 review, the one where I took the camera to Cambodia to shoot an extensive vlog with it in order to showcase all its features. Somewhere in the middle of the video, I'm saying that I'm shooting video, or that I thought I was shooting video, but then I found out that I wasn't recording in the first place. Now I know why. Once you turn on the camera, you have to wait 5 to 6 seconds for it to warm up. And then you can actually press the shutter button or press the video recording button for it to start recording video. What I was doing, I was just whooping out the camera, and then as soon as the display turned on, I was pressing the video record button, and I was thinking I was recording video, and then when I looked at it, I found out I wasn't recording in the first place. So something to keep in mind. I don't know whether it could be avoided or not. It's a bit silly, but yeah, once you turn on the camera, wait for 5 seconds before you start your video recording and you'll be fine. Also, after I reviewed the Panasonic LX10 in Cambodia, I did a follow-up video explaining how to put an ND filter on your Panasonic LX10 using the Macfilter adapter, and how to put a windscreen on the camera as well. And quite frankly, with the ND filter and the windscreen, this is a very capable video shooter now. The image stabilization and the autofocus capabilities are still not that great, but again, it's definitely a video shooter to reckon with. And after I uploaded this video, the brand LensMate sent me its version of its filter kit for the Panasonic LX10. In one of my future videos, I will be demonstrating this adapter kit, and I peeked inside already, and there are definitely some pros and cons that we want to discuss, so watch out for this upcoming video. So let's talk about the DJI Spark, and let me share my thoughts about this drone with you. But before we start, let me set the context as to how I buy my equipment. When I started out with photography 10, 12, 13 years ago, I started out with a small Canon DSLR camera, but moved my way up rather quickly to the Canon 5D Mark II with a 24-70mm L lens. And while this setup was one of the best I've ever owned, it was way too big and heavy for me to carry around all day. So as a substitute, I bought this one, the Fuji X100S, which is probably the most fun camera that I've ever owned, and I really love this camera. So I ended up using this camera all day, which was a fraction of the cost of the Canon 5D Mark II, which then ended up just sitting at home. It was a lot of money spent on equipment that never really saw much use. So this was definitely a lesson learned for me. So what I did going forward was I was shrinking my equipment, whether it's a camera or whether it's a lens, in weight and size, just to make sure I could take it with me as much as possible to get the most use out of the money that I was spending on it. And then when drones came out, and someone like me who always wants to have the latest in toys, I always were at the edge of, you know, buying one. And at some point I couldn't take it any longer, and I bought the Phantom 4. $1,500 investment, I shot 4 or 5 times with it, and then it ended up staying at home most of the time, simply because I couldn't be bothered with taking with me that big box and that big heavy drone. And again, $1,500 and you shot like 4 or 5 times with it. Was it the right investment at that point? Probably it wasn't. And then shortly after I bought my Phantom 4, the Mavic Pro came out. And even though it wasn't on the same level as the Phantom 4 in terms of image quality, in my opinion, it's the better investment. Why? Because you get more usage out of it. You can fold it together, you can put it in your bag, you can take it with you many, many more times, and the more footage you get out of your investment with it, the better investment it is. And with that, let's talk about the Spark. The one thing that is really intriguing about the Spark is its size. And do I mind that the image quality isn't as good as the Mavic Pro or the Phantom 4 Pro? I really don't. If the footage suits the style of video that you shoot, for instance as a vlogger, and you just want to spice up your vlogs with some aerial shots here and there, I think you are plenty fine. The one thing that holds me back of purchasing the Spark is that the arms can't be folded in. With the Mavic Pro, even though heavier and bigger, it has less negative space simply because you can fold everything together so nicely, and it fits pretty much in any bag. And with the Spark and its arms always sticking out, while on paper it may be lighter and smaller, I don't think in handling it makes a lot of difference. And if the couple of $100 more that you would invest in the Mavic Pro isn't a huge obstacle to you, I'd rather go with the Mavic Pro and have a more capable drone than compromising with the Spark. And talking about money, for $499 what you're getting is really the naked drone. If you want to add some extra batteries and the remote control, which brings it closer in terms of capabilities to other drones, you may end up in a price range that is too close to, let's say, the Mavic Pro in order to justify your expense. If you're starting out with drones and you're a beginner, and again, you're like a vlogger, or you just want to use the drone for selfies, I think it's a great way to start using drones, and it probably is a better investment than going for a bigger drone. And I'm not worried about the image quality of the Spark at all. I think it looks plenty good. But if you're a person like me, a prosumer who's after more professional looking footage, I think it's probably the better idea just to wait it out and go for the next version of the Mavic Pro. But again, I'm not necessarily a rational person when it comes to my purchases all the time, so I may end up getting a Spark after all. And yeah, well, if I do, I'll let you guys know. And then fidget spinners, they are everywhere. Everyone on YouTube is going crazy about fidget spinners, and I really didn't understand what this craziness is all about. So to be honest, I bought one myself just to find out what the fuss is all about. And here you go, this is my first fidget spinner. And what I can say is, it spins. And this is how you take a photo of it. So this is it, guys. This is my video for today. If you like this type of video, or if you have any other suggestions or videos I should be shooting, please let me know. If you like this one, however, please like and subscribe. If you have any questions or feedback on any of the topics I covered today, please leave a comment down below. And with that, I catch you guys in my next video.